A warm welcome to all to the next session on electronic devices. In the previous class, we had discussed about the current and voltage in an illuminated junction, out of which we tried to write the current expression which involves the optical generation as well as the thermal generation of the current. Let me just write down that equation and then we'll proceed on how to represent the voltage in case of an illuminated junction. We'll also look into the characteristics for a PN junction when the light is being exposed on it, when it is in the reverse biased. Yeah. So what was the current equation that we considered in the previous class? The current, we know it is the sum of the two currents that is being generated. One is the thermal current and the other is the optical current. How is the thermal current being generated? When we provide certain amount of voltage, what will happen? There is a drift current that starts flowing in the device, and that current is what we refer as thermal current. Whereas the optical current is the one when the light is being exposed, what is happening to the charge carriers or the immobile ions that is present in the depletion region? They tend to provide free electrons and holes that is swept by the p-type material and the n-type material because of the electric field that is present within the depletion region, and that contributes for a current which is called as an optical current. Yeah. So these are all the factors that we have discussed in the previous class. Now, if I consider the equation, how will I write down the final equation? It is Q into A into LP divided by tau P into PN plus LN divided by tau N into NP into e power QV by KT minus 1 minus of Q into A into GOP into LP plus LN plus W. Now, what was this term indicating? It's nothing but your ITH. Done. Now, this whole term, the first whole term that we have, is nothing but the normal diode equation that you consider. Whereas here, this current is because of the optical factor that is involved. Therefore, I can say that the total current is because of the thermal current that is involved and the optical current that is involved. Or I usually say it as, in the textbook they have referred this whole term to be as a normal diode equation. Now we'll see if in case for this particular circuit, if I consider two different conditions, that is when this PN junction is connected to an open circuit, when it is open circuited or when it is short circuited, what is the amount of voltage and current that you are going to observe? Done. Now let me consider the very first case for short circuit condition. So when I perform short circuiting, that means what happens to the supply that I am providing? It is equal to zero. Now, whatever the supply when it is equal to zero, as I mentioned in the earlier class, when I consider the short circuit, it indicates what? The current is maximum, whereas the potential is zero and the resistance is approximately equal to zero. Right? Now, since we know that it is a short circuit, what happens to the current that is being absorbed? We need to know what is the current that is being flowing. Now, when I consider a short circuit, the supply is zero. When the supply is made zero, when this supply itself is made zero, what happens to the thermally generated current that is being absorbed? That current will obviously turns out to be equal to zero because there is no element which is present, which in turn helps you to generate the drift current. Getting my point? As a result, this whole first term becomes equal to zero, and the only current that we can observe is the optical current that is being seen. Therefore, I can say the total current is nothing but the optical current that is being flowing in the device. And why am I considering the negative sign? Because that current is flowing from N towards the P direction. It's the reverse direction the current is being flowing. Done. So this is for the case of short circuit. That is case 1. Now let me consider case 2. What is case 2? It is when I make it as
and open circuit.
When I make it as open circuit, you know what is the current that is being observed in this circuit in the whole PN junction? It can be, I say it as the current is equal to zero. Now, we need to find out the voltage that is being absorbed, right? So, let me represent that voltage to be as VOC, which indicates the open circuit voltage that you can see across the PN junction. And that voltage is given by the equation KT by Q into ln of IOP divided by ITH plus 1. You just have to remember this. We will not be going into the derivation of this equation. You just have to remember this VOC equation, which is given by KT by Q into ln of IOP by ITH plus 1. Now, do we know what is IOP? Yes. Do we know what is ITH? This is the factor. Now, let me just substitute those factors here and try to solve and get an equation for VOC. Okay. Now, I'll just substitute, let me consider this to be as equation 3. I'll just write the IOP equation here. What is the IOP equation? This is Q into A into GOP into LP plus LN plus W. We had already written this in the previous video. Let me just name this as equation 1. ITH, it is Q into A into LP by tau P into PN plus LN by tau N into NP. Let me name this as equation 2. Okay. Let me consider this to be as equation 3 and this as 4. Done? Now, what am I substituting? Equation 1 and 2 in equation 4 and solve. So, substituting equation 1 and 2 in 4 and see what will happen. Yeah. So, therefore, VOC now becomes KT by Q ln of, what is IOP? It is Q A GOP into ln plus LP plus W divided by ITH is Q into A into done. Now, can I cancel out Q and A terms? Finish. Now, what I'll do here is I'll make an assumption. And what is that assumption is, whatever the PN junctions that we have, let that be symmetric in nature. Therefore, for a symmetric or for symmetric, asymmetric meaning is different. That's why I'm telling you, for a symmetric PN junction, what happens to the concentration of holes in the N-type? The concentration of holes in the N-type and the concentration of electrons in the P-type. Since both of them are symmetric in nature, those two quantities have to be equal. Therefore, what will happen to the PN? It is equal to NP. And the average lifetime of hole in case of the N-type material becomes equal to the average lifetime of electron in the P-type material. So, when I consider a symmetric PN junction, the concentration of the holes in the N-type material is equal to the concentration of the electrons in the P-type, and also the average lifetime of the hole in the N-type is equal to the average lifetime of the electrons in the P-type. Now, by getting to know this, what I'll try to do, I'll try to substitute wherever NP is there, I'll substitute it by PN, and wherever tau P is there, tau N is there, I'll substitute it by tau P. Then let me just keep it as a common factor. So this whole term will now be in terms of PN and tau P. Done. So let me do that changes in the above equation. Equation 5. Changing equation 5. Now what will happen? I'll just substitute. VOC is equal to KT by Q into ln into GOP LP plus LN plus W
divided by C. I'll write it as LP divided by tau of P into PN plus LN divided by, instead of tau N, what will I write? I'll write it as tau P. Instead of NP, I'll write it as PN plus 1.
Done? Now, let me just take Pn by tau p as a common factor. Therefore, what will the equation now be? I am writing that equation here. So, VOC is now equal to KT by Q into Ln GOP LP plus Ln plus W divided by Pn by tau of p into LP plus LN plus 1. Now, let's consider the factor W, that is the generation that is happening at the width of the depletion region. Let me just neglect it. So, let's neglect the effect of generation at the width W that is happening. So, when I neglect this term, that is GOP into W, when it is neglected, what am I left out with? Therefore, VOC now becomes equal to KT by Q into LN into GOP into LP plus LN divided by PN by tau P into LP plus LN plus 1. Now, can I cancel this LP plus LN terms? Yes. So, once I cancel it, what will be the term now? I'll write it here. Therefore, VOC is now equal to KT by Q into LN into GOP divided by PN by tau of P plus 1. Let PN by tau of P be equal to GTH. What does GTH indicate? It is the generation of the electron hole pairs thermally under equilibrium condition. Therefore, Pn by tau p is equal to GTH. Let me just substitute that here. And let's assume that the GOP is very much greater than that of GTH. Now, VOC is equal to KT by Q ln GOP by GTH plus 1. Now, what is the assumption that I am making? The generation of the charge carriers, that is the EHP pairs, optically is very much greater than the amount of EHP pairs that is being generated thermally. Now, when that becomes greater, what happens to this factor? This factor dominates when compared to that of this one, right? Therefore, this one can be neglected and then VOC can be written as KT by Q into LN of GOP by GTH. And this is an equation which relates to the open circuit voltage related to the generation of the EHPs optically and generation of the EHPs which happens thermally. Now, I'll say it as approximately equals because we have made some assumptions in between. Therefore, I can say it as it is approximately equal to this particular factor. Now, you can question me, will this VOC keeps on increasing or the open circuit voltage that is being observed, will that keep on increasing as I tend to increase the optical generation? No, it cannot happen indefinitely. There is certain limitation that is present and that limitation is nothing but when this VOC reaches up to the value which is equal to the forward bias potential or the electrostatic potential that is observed in the equilibrium condition. So only once till that reaches this point, only then you can provide or you can generate the EHP pairs optically. Once it crosses that, it can no longer increase in nature. So, there is certain limitation that is being offered for the open circuit voltage that is being observed because of the optical generation that is involved. Done. So what is the condition here? The GOP, as I tend to increase the GOP, it does not mean that the VOC increases indefinitely. There is a limitation that is being offered. What is that limitation? The VOC can increase only up to the electrostatic potential that is absorbed at the depletion region. How will I represent that electrostatic potential? We know that electrostatic potential is represented as V naught. Therefore, my VOC cannot cross V naught. Until then only it can increase the, or we can find out the open circuit voltage to be equal to V naught. Done. So these are all the factors that you have to understand regarding the voltages and the currents that is being absorbed in an illuminated junction. Now one more point is left out, that is the representation of the reverse current that is flowing as a function of the optical generation. Now we'll just look into that and how to represent an IV characteristic including GOP. Now we know that this is the input voltage and the output current. During the forward bias condition, this is the curve that is being absorbed. And during the reverse bias, when there is no optical generation, at that point we'll be observing some reverse saturation current that is flowing because of thermal generation of the current. And at this point, what is my optical generation? It is equal to zero. Now, as I tend to provide light, as I tend to focus light on this PN junction, that is the diffusion region overall across the PN junction, what starts happening? The current starts generated. It is getting generated and the current, reverse current that we observe tend to increase, right? So how will I show that? So that increase is what I'll be showing right now. See, as you can see, this intersection that is happening in the current axis is at different values, right? So on what basis I am writing different intersections is, it is based on how much light that I am providing, so that how much of generations of EHP pairs is taking place. So let me represent that generation factors to be as G1, G2 and G3. So as I tend to provide more amount of light, what happens? More amount of immobile ions tend to break the covalent bonds and generate the free electrons and holes, which is getting swept, the holes getting swept to the P side and electrons getting swept to the N side. As a result, the number of charge carriers at N and P increases, which in turn increases the amount of current that is being seen. Right? So more the amount of generation, more the amount of current that is being absorbed. Less the amount of generation, less the amount of light intensity, less is the amount of current that is being seen. Yeah, therefore you need to be very careful with this. Therefore, what can I write the condition as? G3 is greater than that of G2, is greater than that of G1. So based on this condition, I am writing the how it is being absorbed. And the current is negative. Keep that in mind always. Whatever the current that is flowing here because of the optical generation is negative here. Yeah, and this is regarding the characteristics of the IV in case of an illuminated junction. I hope all of you understood with the factors that I've considered. So I'll just recall it, what we tried to understood. We tried to understand when a light of intensity H nu, which is greater than the energy of the semiconductor band gap, is made to fall on a P-type and N-type PN junction material, what will happen? There is a generation of the EHP pairs in this region as well as in the depletion region as well as in the N region. Since these are the ones that are the neutral regions, I am not interested in these regions. Whereas this is the region where there is an electric field that is being generated, and this is the region where the immobile ions tend to generate the free electrons and holes, which is swept by the N-type and the P-type respectively based on the electric field intensity that is present. Now, once that happens, what happens to the number of carriers that is absorbed at the N-type? It increases. What happens to the holes that is present in the P-type? It increases. As a result, the amount of reverse current that I can find in the P-N junction because of the light that is being incident on the P-N junction increases. And we also looked into the current equation and the voltage equation for different conditions like open circuit and short circuit. And we also understood half the optical, as the factor of optical generation increases, what happens to the current, even that will increase. And since it is flowing from N to P, I am considering the current to be as a negative factor. That's why I am representing it at these axes. Yeah. So once you are done with this, we'll consider three different cases and try to represent when this P-N junction is forward biased and when it is reverse biased. There are three different quadrants of operations that takes place. I'll just summarize it now and then we'll try to relate that when we consider the subtopics like solar cells and photodetectors. Okay. However connected to the terminals here, it is plus is connected to the P-type and N is connected to the N-type. Therefore, this indicates what? The forward biased condition. Whereas, here the polarity is changed, which indicates it is the reverse biased condition that I am considering. See, observe the current directions and be careful. That is how you are supposed to represent. IR here indicates the reverse current that is flowing in the device. Now, what is this condition? There is no supply that is being connected, only a load is being connected to this P-N junction. Whereas the potentials that I see here is, it is a positive here whereas a negative here. Now how does this basically happens? We'll clearly understand when we consider the next upcoming topic, which is about the solar cells. Yeah. Now what happens to the characteristics? I'll just represent the characteristics here and all these you have to consider under different quadrants. So when I consider the forward bias, it is regarding the first quadrant that I am interested in. Yeah, when I consider the reverse bias and there is a certain amount of current that is flowing, if I provide a biasing, then it is about the third quadrant that I am interested in. The third quadrant that I am interested in. Whereas, the region where this is the region, that is the fourth quadrant, now we have considered the same graph but we are pointing out into different quadrants. So this particular figure relates to the first quadrant where I am trying to provide some positive voltage and I am observing a positive current. Again here, this is a condition wherein I am providing a reverse bias condition, that is a negative voltage and a negative current is being observed. That is where I will be observing the third quadrant. When I consider the first and the third quadrant here, the power to the P-N junction is being delivered by the external source that is present. Please keep this point here. So which is the source that is providing to which one? The power is being provided by the external circuit to the P-N junction in both of these cases. Whereas The special case that comes into picture is this case wherein I observe that the voltage is positive whereas the current that is being absorbed is negative, and this is operation in the fourth quadrant where my PN junction is the one which is providing the power to the external circuit. In these two cases, the external circuits used to provide the power to the PN junction, whereas here the PN junction itself will act as a power source and it will generate a current which can flow through the resistor. That's why we have not connected any external biasing circuit here. Now let's try to understand this particular case by considering the application, that is solar cells. Done? Now, the next application that we are looking into in case of PN junction diode is solar cells, which is a subtopic under the photodiodes. Now, this solar cells behaves as the ones which will generate the power to the external node. Therefore, I have kept this graph and this circuit as it is. Now, we'll first try to understand what is a solar cell, how it is being constructed, what is the operation principle of the solar cell, and then we'll try to relate that to the third characteristics that we had seen in the previous section, that is the fourth quadrant operation. Okay, now where you can see the solar cells, what does basically a solar cell do? So this is a kind of a PN junction device that will help you to convert the solar energy into the electrical energy. So what is the basic principle of this solar cells? It converts the sun or the solar energy into electrical energy. So this is the basic principle or the functionality of a solar cell. Now, how does this convert the solar energy into electrical energy and how can it provide the current to the external load? Let me try to make you understand in the principle or the working operation of the solar cells. Before going into that, it is very much important for you to understand the constructional details of the solar cell. So, the next thing that we'll be discussing is about the constructional details. Now, let me consider the duster that you're seeing right now as a PN junction. One key point that you have to understand here is, if in case the sun rays are falling onto this whiter surface, then you need to ensure that that particular region of the semiconductor have to be of very thin material. Let me repeat, wherever the light energy is being flowing, that particular region of the PN junction have to be very thin in nature. Yeah, whereas the other side can be of little thicker. Now, if in case I consider this as a PN junction, if this is your N layer, that is the white part is your N layer, whereas the black part is your P type material, what does this forms? It forms a PN junction. Now, what do we have in between a PN junction? We have what is called as a depletion region, right? So, which type of a material is facing the sunlight? The N type of the material is facing the sunlight. Therefore, I need to ensure the phase, whichever is facing towards the sunlight, have to be thin in design So therefore, while doping, what we'll try to do is, we'll try to perform a precise and controlled doping in such a way that the N-type is made thin and the P-type is made little thick. Now, you might question me, what is the reason of doing such a construction? The reason for this is, when the sunlight penetrates into the N region, it has to reach up to the P region, and also it has to hit the depletion region, right? Because depletion region is the region where we are interested in. It is region where the immobile charge carriers are present, which can generate free electrons and holes. If in turn I make this N region to be thick, whatever the sunlight that is penetrating, it cannot, by the time it penetrates, it will lose its intensity. The light energy will lose its intensity. As a result, it cannot penetrate deeper into the PN junction. Hence, I need to ensure the upper layer should be thin and the lower layer can be little thick. It cannot be too thick. It has to be a little thick. Done? Now, let me try to represent this structure over the board. See, this diagram, whatever I am writing now, it's not there in your textbook. It is only for your understanding. I am writing this figure. I'll tell you which diagrams to write when it is asked in the exam. Free electrons are being generated. Free holes are being generated. Done. Now, we know that because of this depletion region, there is a built-in electric field. As a result, does these free electrons and holes can recombine again? No, it cannot recombine. Because of the electric field that is being present, there is a certain amount of force that acts on the free electrons and holes. As a result, what is happening? These free electrons get swept to the N side of the material and these free holes get swept to the P side of the material. Done. As a result, what happens to the electrons that was present in the N-type? Priorly it was less. Now the number of electrons gets increased. Here also the number of holes gets increased. Yeah. Now, as the number of electrons tends to increase here, now, what is the kind of potential that you can absorb? This is a negative particle, whereas this is a positive particle, right? Therefore, as a result, there is a kind of potential that exists between this P and N regions. Done? So, this kind of potential that exists, let me represent it through the polarities, that is positive and negative polarities. Done. Now, when this positive and negative polarities are being generated, if in case I tend to connect a load across this particular material now, what will happen is, the electrons that was present here, which tends to accumulate, try to move across and then gets accumulated to the hole that was present in the P-type. As a result, there is a current that is being flowing from the N-type material to that of the P-type material. That is, the electrons which is flowing from the N-type to that of the P-type. If the electrons are flowing from N to P, how about the conventional current? The conventional current has to flow from this direction to this direction, right? That means the current, a conventional current has to flow from N to P, whereas the electron current is flowing in this direction. Get this point clear? How the electron current is flowing? It is flowing in this direction, whereas the conventional current is flowing in this direction. Therefore, I say the conventional current flows from which region to which region? It is flowing from N to P region. Let me just repeat again what happened. Because of the intensity of the light, the free charge carriers were generated. The electrons here get swept to the N side. As a result, more number of electrons created in N side. The holes that was generated here swept by the P type because of the electric field that is present. As a result, the number of holes here tends to increase. Now, since more number of holes are there, there is a potential, positive potential that is generated, which is referred as plus, and negative potential that is generated, which is represented as minus. Now, this electrons, how it tends to flow? This tends to flow from this point to that of this point. How does the conventional current flow? It has to be in the reverse direction, which is from N to P. Done. So this is regarding the operation of the solar cells, and that's how we tend to, or this PN junction tends to provide certain amount of current to the external load that is being present. Therefore, we are not connecting any external biasing in this kind of circuitry. This is the same circuit that I've represented here. See the positive potential, the negative potential that I have represented, and that is the potential that is being generated, and because of which there is a current flow in the device, and this PN junction is providing power to the external circuitry, and this operation is in the fourth quadrant. Therefore, whenever I want to have a scenario where I need to provide, or where the PN junction have to provide power to the external circuit, then I make the device to operate in the fourth quadrant. Done. I hope all of you are clear till here. Done. Now, one key point here you have to understand is, I am not done with the construction yet. So, until and unless you understood these points, I cannot proceed further with respect to the construction. Now, as you have understood that the electrons which is present here tends to move in this direction, just imagine that if the electrons which is present here, when it has to move all throughout the surface in the N and then go to this load, what is happening? It has to move a little distance. As a result, the more the electron moves, the more the amount of energy tends to reduce, right? Because there is a resistance that is offered in the N-type material. So what I'll try to do is, I'll try to minimize the electron movement. Now, how can I minimize this electron movement is by placing what is called as metal fingers onto the N-type and the P-type material. Now, how can I place that? See, this is how I'll be placing it. Now, what are these metal fingers made of? It is made up of metal, as the name itself indicates. And why it is called as fingers? Because this is your N-type region that you have, right? So, to this N-type region, this is the metal finger that I am placing like this. Now, what is the purpose of placing this metal fingers is, if there is an electron that is flowing somewhere here, it gets absorbed by this material, that is the metal that is present. If there is an electron somewhere here, it either gets absorbed by this metal finger or by this metal finger. As a result, the conductivity of the electrons improves and there is a little loss of energy that takes place. Done. Therefore, I'll always place metal fingers onto the P and the N surface. Done. Now, can't I place this metal fingers completely over the silicon surface like this? No, it's not possible. Why? Because whenever the sunlight incidents on this, the whole conducting layer will itself absorb the light energy, right? Now, do I want that, or do I want my light energy to penetrate into the N-type and P-type materials? I need that penetration to happen, right? Therefore, what will I do? I'll place in terms of fingers such a way that there is enough gap that is present in between through which the sunlight can penetrate deeply and then perform its required operation. As a result, I am placing the metals as a finger-like structure. So, what are these regions? These are the regions where it is allowing the sunlight energy to penetrate into deeper to that of the depletion region. And therefore, this metal layers or the metal fingers is also referred as the conductive layer. See, in your homes you have solar panels, right? So, tend to go and observe that you can find some silver kind of linings over there, and that silver kind of box kinds of linings, that rectangular boxes that you can find, is nothing but the metal fingers that I'm representing. Yeah, and the blue color surface that is underlying is nothing but your PN junction that you have, and along with that you have whatever that blue kind is, because of you're placing what is called as a reflective layer. So once you have an NP junction upon which you are placing metal fingers, upon that you are placing another layer which is called as a reflective layer. Now you might question me, what is the reason for placing this reflective layers? See, once the lights get incident, its nature itself is to reflect back. Some of the light energy may tend to reflect back, right? Now I want to use that reflective light energy as well. Now how can I do that is by providing an anti-reflecting layer. Sorry, this is anti-reflecting layer. What is the meaning of anti-reflecting layer? So if in case this is your anti-reflecting layer, whatever the light that was supposed to reflect, it will come back to the PN junction and gets absorbed as well. So I need to use as much amount of light energy as possible. Therefore, I'll place an anti-reflective layer which helps to make the light absorption as maximum as possible. Therefore, what all we have in the construction? We have an N region and a P region. N region, which is the one which is facing towards the light energy, so that has to be thin, whereas the bottom layer can be little thick. Upon which I'm placing metal fingers. That is nothing but the conductive layer which helps the electrons not to move maximum. As a result, the energy reduction that can happen because of the moment can be reduced. And upon which I am placing an anti-reflecting coating which helps you to absorb as much amount of light energy as possible. And this is the final construction of the solar cells that we have. And this is regarding the working details of the solar cells. I hope all of you are clear till here. Yes, now as I told, there is accumulation of electrons here and accumulation of holes here. As a result, there is a potential that exists, which is represented by the polarities, and there is a current flow that happens. The electrons move in this direction, whereas the holes, that is the conventional current direction, is in the reverse. Therefore, I say the current flows from N to P, which is negative, whereas the applied, the potential that can be seen is positive, just like the battery. And therefore, I'm considering it at the quadrant 4. Yeah, so this is all regarding the solar cells. Now, I can't write this complex circuitry here, whatever the construction that I have. Instead, we have a simple circuit. Or a simple diagram. Let me just represent that diagram and show you. So this is your N, this is your P. Done. Now what do we have? A metal fingers, that is nothing but the conductive metal layer. So these are nothing but the metal layers which are conductive in nature. Done. Now what does this indicates? It is nothing but the anti-reflecting layer, and both of this also indicates the anti-reflecting layer, and this is where I'm making my light to fall on, which is greater than that of Eg, and this is the basic construction of the solar cell, and this is what the figure you are supposed to represent when it is asked in the internals or in the exam. Done. Now if in case I want to represent the metal fingers, what are these? These are the metal fingers which, if there is an electron, it tends to get absorbed by this. If there is an electron here, whichever conducting line which is present, metal line which is present, so near to that it gets absorbed, right? So that is how we have metal fingers that is being placed. Yeah, so these two are the figures that you're supposed to write for a solar cell. I hope all of you are clear with the constructional details and with the working principle. Now let's look into what is referred as the graphical representation, that is whatever the fourth quadrant that we had. So within this quadrant we have few more points to include. So let me just represent only this fourth quadrant and then try to explain those concepts. Okay. So for simplicity, what I'll do is I'll try to represent it in an inverted form. Actually it was supposed to be in the fourth quadrant, but I'm considering a mirror image and representing. So this is your reverse current that is flowing, this is the potential, and this is the zero axis. Yeah,
and then let me represent the short circuit current and the open circuit voltage. How did I get this short circuit and current and open circuit voltage? It is totally based on the property of the material that I am using for the solar cells. And let me just connect these two through a curve. And that is nothing but this curve that I am representing. Okay, now whatever the amount of maximum power that can be delivered from this PN junction to the load that is being connected as a product of the voltage, that is the reverse current and the voltage that is present. So the maximum power that can be absorbed or that can be delivered to the external load as a product of what? The reverse current and the voltage. We know the power formula, right? It is I into V. So which I am referring, it is the reverse current and the potential that was generated. Done. Now how can I represent them? So that maximum voltage that I can see, which helps for the maximum power delivering, that is Vm, and the maximum current is represented as Im. So if I want to represent a plot, so this rectangle shade that I'm writing is the one which indicates the amount of maximum voltage and current that can be generated by this PN junction, by the solar cell, which is delivered to the load. Done? And this is what this graph basically indicates. Now we have a factor which is called as fill factor. Now this fill factor is nothing but a factor which defines or which relates to the maximum voltage, current and ISC and VOC. As you can observe, the Vm and Im product is not as same as that of the ISC and VOC. So we'll be using a factor which is nothing but a fill factor which relates to these factors. So what does that indicate? It is Vm into Im, which is given by Vm into Im divided by VOC into ISC. Done. So this is regarding the fill factor, which indicates the relationship between Vm, Im, VOC and ISC. So these are all the aspects that you need to be aware of regarding the solar cells. Yeah, so the lower the light intensity, lower is the current. Higher the light intensity, the maximum amount of current is being generated. So this is about the constructional details and the working principle and the characteristics related to the solar cells. Now let's try to solve a problem related to the same. Whatever a single solar cell that I consider, it can provide an voltage of 0.5 to 0.6 volts. That is regarding a single solar cell. So this much amount of voltage, is it sufficient to drive any kind of application? No, it's not possible. Therefore, what I'll try to do is, we'll try to connect these solar cells in series. As a result, we can achieve more amount of voltage and more amount of current generation. And that arrangement of solar cells in series will result in what is called as solar panels that you can find in different kinds of applications. Yeah, the other applications where you can see the solar cells is the calculators that you are using, the batteries, or the what is called as the torch that you are using. So all these involves the applications of the solar cells. If these are arranged in series and in order to generate more amount of voltage and current, that is what it will result in, the solar panels. Yeah, these solar panels find its importance in also in the satellites, where you can see at the wings, these solar panels are being installed, are being padded up so that they can extract the sunlight energy, convert it into voltage and provide that voltage to the different kinds of circuits that is there in the satellites, that helps to make it work, which is more efficient than the kinds of batteries that we have. Yeah. So as you know that the renewable energy sources are the sources that we are looking into. Whatever the energy that we are creating because of the fossil fuels are getting extinct, right? So in several hundred years, it is very difficult for you to generate power using the fossil fuels. Therefore, it is very much important for us to look into the alternative solutions for power generation. And one of the efficient
Or one of the best solutions that is provided so far is the conversion of solar energy into the electrical energy. Even though it has an efficiency of only 25%, this is the one of the solutions that is being provided to ensure the solar energy is used to make it into convert into the electrical energy. So this is regarding the applications of the solar cells. Now coming back, the problem, a silicon solar cell has a short circuit current. So he has given one data. What is that? The short circuit current is 100 milliamps, and he is telling an open circuit voltage is of 8.8 volts. So it is VOC which he is speaking about, and under the full solar illumination, so the complete light energy is being utilized is what he is telling. Now utilization, it is completely exposed to the sunlight. Now the fill factor that we have is how much? Let me just write it in this short form, FF, which is equal to 0.7. He is asking me to find out what is the maximum power that is delivered to the load by this particular cell. So in order to find out that, the maximum power is given by fill factor into the short circuit current into the open circuit voltage. What is the fill factor value? 0.7 into 100 milli into 0.8, which turns out to be 56 milliwatt. The maximum power that was generated by a single solar cell which has these factors involved is 56 milliwatt. And this completes the topic solar cells. I hope all of you have understood this. Thank you one and all. Have a good day.